Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Your Highest Calling. Discover the Secret Processes That Fulfill Your Destiny by Dr. Bill Hamon. Foreword by Jennifer LeClaire. Narrated by Tom Parks. Foreword. Standing on a North Miami Beach bridge with yachts passing by in the dark blue water, my husband presented me with diamond earrings. He wanted to renew our wedding vows. It was a grand goodbye as he set out on a month-long trip to Latin America on a special work assignment. That was the last time I ever saw him. After a goodbye kiss, he promised to call when he landed. Several hours after my phone should have rung, there was no call. I did not think too much of it, since cell coverage was spotty in the region. The next morning, however, our 2-year-old daughter started asking for Daddy, so I called again. No answer. Days went by, then weeks. I could not reach him. My concern was growing, and my baby was increasingly adamant about seeing Daddy. After 3 weeks passed, a friend urged me to call the U.S. Embassy to help find him. What I found out was shocking. He had never entered the country to which he told me he was headed. With my investigative journalism skills, I tracked his location through news organizations. I was told what country he was in and given a phone number where I could reach him. When I called the number, a Spanish-speaking man answered. I asked him to put my husband on the phone. The man on the other end insisted that my husband was divorced and engaged to marry his daughter. That is how I found out my husband had abandoned me. It was a life-changing, mind-blowing, earth-shattering event, and it would not be the first one. Within months, I was accused of a crime I did not commit and landed in jail, fighting for my freedom. After 40 days, I was vindicated and released, but it cost me every penny I had. I came out of jail with a small child, no job, no home, and no money. Decades ago, when I was picking up the pieces of my broken life, I had no idea that God would use the devil's 1-2 punch to prepare me for my highest calling. I discovered that Romans chapter 8, verse 28 is true. God really does work all things for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. I also realized that what does not kill us really does make us stronger. I learned that the trying of my faith was working patience in me so I could walk in my destiny. I endured several life-changing, mind-blowing, earth-shattering events as I pursued God's highest calling on my life. I survived spiritual abuse at the hands of a controlling church leader. When I left, I lost every friend and every ministry position I had and sat on a shelf for several years. During that time, I had no idea that God was moving me into my life's work, beginning with the launch of Awakening House of Prayer. Nor did I have a clue that He was going to make me the first ever female editor of Charisma magazine. Some years later, my body started shutting down for no medical reason. I felt as if I were losing, day by day, everything I had built over the last 20 years. I was frustrated beyond measure. It was a spiritual attack. False prophets were cursing me, and it was affecting my health. When the curse was broken and I recovered, I walked away having learned to rest in spiritual warfare. It was a vital lesson for the next season. I had no idea that God would start sending me to the nations of the earth to raise up prophets to throw Jezebel off a wall. See 2 Kings chapter 9, verses 30 through 33. You may not have to go through the extreme trials and tragedies I have endured, or maybe yours have been more intense. God does not bring those trials and tragedies, but He does use them to prepare us for our highest calling. Bishop Hammond's book will encourage you as you walk through your process. you will find understanding into why you are experiencing suffering, inspiration that keeps you from giving up, and revelation that will put in you a determination to reach your highest calling in Christ. Every Christian needs to listen to this book. Jennifer LeClaire, Senior Leader, Awakening House of Prayer in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, Founder Ignite Network, Founder Awakening Blaze Prayer Movement. Introduction. Out of the 14 books that I have written, this one concerning God's highest calling is the most important. The truths found within this book will affect a Christian's eternal rewards and relationship with Jesus Christ throughout eternity. Understanding God's highest calling for His children gives wisdom and insight concerning the tests, trials, and personal suffering that are experienced in life. Jesus declared that when we know the truth on a matter, it sets us free to fulfill life without the horrible discouragement and frustration that the average person experiences when facing difficult times. In the first few chapters, we will discover some of the main reasons that motivated God to create man. Man had to be made a certain way from certain material and placed in a special place. This was necessary in order for God to fulfill His plans. We will hear why man could not be made in heaven out of heavenly material. Man was completely new, different from all other created beings. Man was a revelation to all, but the making of woman was a revolution. Angels had never seen such a beautiful and challenging creature in all their existence, for they do not have females in their race. At least, there is no record in the Bible of someone seeing and talking to an angel and thinking it was a woman. Nevertheless, God created mankind as male and female to reproduce and fill the earth with a race in God's image and likeness. In the 10th chapter of this book, we will discuss additional reasons God had for man and woman marrying and becoming one. Most preachers and most lay people know that being conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus is God's highest calling for His children. What is not as well known, however, is the process that God uses to fulfill His predestined purpose for us. This process involves two principles, the law of transformation and the process for conformity to the image and likeness of Christ. A number of years ago, while a professor in a Christian college, I taught students the 8 reasons or purposes that answer the question, "Why man?" and explained what God wanted to accomplish through this race. Later, I discussed these principles in my book, Who Am I and Why Am I Here? The number one purpose, of course, was for Adam and Eve to reproduce themselves until the earth was filled with the race of humankind in God's image and likeness. Adam and Eve failed by disobeying God in the Garden of Eden. They lost their likeness of God in character and nature, but kept their reproducing ability. Jesus Christ came 4,000 years later and started a new race by, first, purchasing man with His blood shed on the cross. He then sent the Holy Spirit, who enabled individuals to be born again, and thereby to become new creations in Christ, thus starting the new race of mankind called the church race. In this new church race, individuals are not recognized by natural nationality or as Jew or Gentile, but by the name of Christian. These are God's special people whom He has chosen to be conformed to the likeness of His Son. God has appointed Jesus to be the head of this new race, both now and throughout eternity. Those from this race who submit to and go through God's process for conforming them to the likeness of Christ in every area of His being will be chosen to rule and reign with Jesus in fulfilling God's eternal purposes. In this book, I will be explaining the revelation of God's highest calling for individual Christians. I will share many ministries that we have fulfilled, but at this point, I want to share the fact that there are 7 major anointings upon my life and Christian International Ministries. I want to emphasize the one that has been the greatest blessing to my wife and me over the years, the family anointing. Our 3 children have served the Lord all the days of their lives. They are all parents now of our 11 grandchildren and grandparents of our 18 great-grandchildren. All 3 are major leaders in Christian International Ministries. They all prophesy and preach, and we have all written books. In fact, my daughter, Sherilyn, has just completed her first book, Stewarding Your Best Life. It is complementary to this book, as it talks about the fact that you own nothing, but you owe everything to Jesus Christ. Jesus bought us, body, soul, and spirit, with His blood. Everything we are and have belongs to Jesus. We are the stewards and managers of all that God has given us. Our rewards will be based on how we manage all He has given to us. Our key scripture for this study will be Romans chapter 8, verses 28 through 29. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. For whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. In chapter after chapter, I will be using various scriptures, biblical examples, and personal experiences to show how all things do work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose of having each one conformed to the likeness of His Son, so that Jesus will be the firstborn among many who are in His likeness. When you understand the application of 2 illustrations we will be discussing, first, of the thumb and fingers representing the inner man and the outer man, and second, the law of aerodynamics versus the law of gravity, you will understand how God can put you through trials that seem to be against His general will and yet are in His higher will as part of your processing. It will knock the why out of the trials and tests you go through. I have numerous testimonies from those who went through my mentoring day where these truths were taught and became birthed within them. This changed their lives, helping them to go forward more victoriously as Christians. You will experience the same by the time you have finished listening to this book. I am grateful that Jesus called and anointed me to be a pioneer in the restoration of His church. I am seeking with all I am and have to fulfill all He has given me to do. I want to hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." But I am more thankful that He revealed to me what His highest calling is, to be conformed to His image and likeness, mature sons and daughters whom He can trust with His affairs and eternal kingdom. Chapter 1. God's Purpose for His Greatest Creation. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. To understand God's highest calling for humankind, we must discover all the many reasons God had for creating the human race. God was not alone when He created humankind. He did not create people because He was lonely. Fellowship is one reason for our existence, but there were other factors that were more meaningful and purposeful to God. Before man came into being, heaven, in fact, was filled with several types of creatures that God had made in the eternal past before He made man. The Bible reveals 3 types of heavenly spirit beings that were with Him in His domain before man appeared on the earth. There are trillions of angels, which we will call the angelic race. There are also numerous cherubim and seraphim. Each of these 3 groups of beings looks different from the others and has different functions to perform. But somewhere in the eternal past, God planned the whole eternal future, which included the creation of man. Sometime in the beginning, when there was no one and nothing but God, he conceived of the plan to create the heavens and the earth. In fact, everything that now fills endless space, including the far reaches of our universe, was planned by God. He created the cherubim, seraphim, and angels, but he also had plans to create a new race of beings who would be different from anything he had created before. At the right time, a new race. When the time was right, God activated his plan to create this new race that would fulfill many desires and purposes for him. When we use the word time, we are expressing earthly terminology, because there was no such thing as years, months, days, hours, not until God established earth as the place where he would put his special and unique creation. He would call this new race of being man. This book is written to that race to which you and I belong. We will answer such questions as, why did God create the human race? We will discover why some of God's plans and purposes for us required that man not be made in heaven out of heavenly material, but from the dust of the planet called Earth. We will reveal several things God wanted to accomplish through humankind. We will discover why the human race is called to be the highest race in the universe. We will then concentrate on the highest calling for every member of the human race, especially those who have become members of the new race, the church race. There is a reason why everything had to be exactly the way God established it. Our goal: to understand the process. If I asked you about the reason for the creation of humankind, you would most likely know that it is Father God's will for his people to be conformed into the image and likeness of Jesus Christ, his Son. Most Christians know this. What is not as well known is the process God uses to fulfill that purpose. I am establishing two terms in this book to represent how God accomplishes his purpose for his sons and daughters to be like Jesus. Both phrases will be capitalized as proper nouns to show their importance in representing the main subject of the book: the method God uses to conform redeemed ones into the likeness of Christ Jesus. These descriptive terms will be used many times throughout the book: the law of transformation and God's process for conformity, or simply transformation and process. Many biblical and personal stories will help illustrate these terms and make them real. I rarely have time to preach this truth in the pulpit. That is one of the main reasons I started conducting a mentoring day, which imparts the truths found in this book. Most of my pulpit preaching throughout the world deals with the restoration movements within the church, where the church is right now in God's present and progressive purpose for her. I was privileged to be commissioned to pioneer the prophetic movement that was birthed in 1988. We prophesied the Saints movement that was birthed in 2007. The Third Reformation in 2008 and the Army of the Lord movement activated offensive spiritual warfare in 2016. I wrote books on each one of these moves of God. This book is different in that it deals with the individual as opposed to the corporate church. Here, you will discover truths that will enlighten and endow you with the wisdom and power to make your life and ministry victorious to the end. Trials and rewards in the process. There is one further thing I want you to know. I will not be writing much about my successes and what I have accomplished in life, for this book is about God's process for conforming us to the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. But I will mention one or two of the glorious, life-fulfilling, joyous times my wife and I experienced. I do not want you to think that we lived through one continuous trial, for the tests came only when God saw that we were ready to go through the process again to reach our next level. Since most of the truths that will be presented here come from the writings of the Apostle Paul, I will take the attitude that Paul took. When Paul talks about his infirmities, he includes those things that made him weak in the natural and what natural things he lost by going through the conforming process. This includes his tests, trials, suffering, persecution. Everything in the natural that seemed to be a negative experience in his life. Paul wrote, "If I must boast, I will boast in the things which confirm my infirmity. I will not boast except in my infirmities." 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 30, chapter 12, verse 5. But along with the trials, like Paul, I want to mention a few of God's blessings that came to us in order to encourage you that God does promote and reward His children after every process for conformity that we allow Him to take us through. God's tests and trials during the process are not continuous. Just as tests in school are given at the end of a learning session or at the end of the school year to determine whether or not we are ready to graduate to the next level, so after every conforming process, God gives a greater ministry and rewards us in many ways. The harder He allowed me to be thrown down, the higher Jesus enabled me to bounce back, like a super bounce rubber ball. Here is one example of reward and favor for letting God take me through the process for conformity into the likeness of His Son. Between 1969 and 1972, I was going through the process. There were two betrayals, my preaching ministry was greatly reduced, and there were some heartbreaking and hopeless situations. Yet at the end of that process, on January 24, 1973, God gave me a divine visitation that enabled me to prophesy to numerous people for several continuous hours. He also gave me the revelation and ability to activate and train others in prophetic ministry. God gave me the anointing to be a reproducer of reproducers who would reproduce other reproducers of prophets and prophetic ministry. This resulted in my prophesying over the following 40 years to more than 50,000 individuals, from babies to kings and presidents of nations, and training more than 500,000 people in prophetic ministry in every continent of the world. I was honored to be named by Charisma magazine in an issue dedicated to ministers who have most influenced the church in the past four decades as the pioneering father of the prophetic movement. This came after 64 years of ministry and many, many processes for conformity to the likeness of Jesus Christ. Your own journey begins. As you listen to this book, you might think, could all that he and his wife went through have been purposed by God? Was it worth it all? I can say yes, absolutely, during this life and more so in the life to come throughout eternity. By the time you have finished this book, you will be able to say the same with great conviction and confidence. You are embarking on an enlightening and challenging journey that will bring revelation and transformation into your life and enable you to fulfill God's highest calling for you. I believe that we all desire to become the kind of persons that God wants with Him throughout eternity. We want to hear those very important words from our Creator, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You fulfilled my highest calling for you. You fulfilled the membership ministry I gave you when I baptized you into the body of Christ. Come now and live and reign with me throughout eternity." Acknowledgement and petition. Almighty God, I acknowledge that you created humankind. Your first couple failed, but you sent your Son, and He fulfilled and demonstrated the type of person you want. I want to be your type of person, like Jesus. I surrender my all to your process to grow me in Christ-likeness. Chapter 2. What is man? What is man that you are mindful of him, or the Son of Man that you take care of him? Hebrews chapter 2, verse 6. The Bible makes it clear that God created humans with his own two hands and breathed into them an eternal spirit. Animals have lungs and breathe air as well. But God did not breathe his breath of life into them as he did with man. That is the reason humankind has an eternal spirit and the capacity to be resurrected bodily, but animals do not. Humans did not evolve from a lower species developing gradually. God created Adam and Eve not as babies, but as full-grown, intelligent individuals. Those who propagate the theory of evolution are basing it on human imagination without factual scientific proof. This is mainly because natural man does not want to acknowledge that there is a God who created everything, including humankind. The Biblical Record of Man on Planet Earth. The plans and purposes God had for creating this special race required that humankind be made a certain way and be placed in a specific area. God could not place man in heaven, for he knew that man would end up sinning. Sin cannot be allowed in heaven, nor could man continue living in sin in heaven. Man had to exist and function outside of God's throne area. His home had to be outside of heaven, on a planet in a certain part of the universe. God chose a distant planet in one of the solar systems within the Milky Way galaxy. Planet Earth is located some 27,000 light-years from the center of this galaxy. A light-year is how far light travels at 186,287 miles per second in 1 year, which is about 6 trillion miles. Our Milky Way galaxy is 200,000 light-years across. It is just one of multi-millions of galaxies in God's universe. If humankind could develop the ability to travel at the speed of light, it would still take 200,000 years to travel across our galaxy. We don't know whether heaven's throne is light years away or in a different dimension. Earth was to be man's home for an indefinite period. The body of man was made from the dust of the earth, to live on the earth, and to have dominion over everything on the earth. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. God made a special place on the earth where the humans would live. See Genesis chapter 2, verse 8. He brought from heaven seeds from the trees, flowers, fruit trees, and the rest of the vegetation, and planted them in a special area and named that great park the Garden of Eden. That gave man a little piece of heaven on earth. Jesus has made a place of heaven on earth for us to live in, called a heavenly place in Christ Jesus. God made us alive together with Christ and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 5 through 6. The physical body of man. This special creature called man had to be made a certain way in order to fulfill all the purposes for which God was creating him. Man was made different from the angels. God had so many things planned for man to fulfill that nothing less than being made in God's own image and likeness would do. Image means to look like God's bodily appearance. Likeness means to have God-like attributes, character, and capabilities. Man was made with an independent life in that God gave him the power and right to make decisions on his own. Man could say yes or no to God's commands and will. He could also say yes or no to any of the devil's suggestions. He had the power of choice. Adam was, therefore, a free moral agent. When God was designing the human body, he not only had himself as a pattern, but also was thinking of the body that he wanted his son to have when he came to earth to be a man. Jesus would have that body while he walked the earth as a mortal. It would be crucified and placed in a grave. But Father God would resurrect that mankind body to be an immortal and eternal flesh and bone body. Jesus is now sitting at the right hand of God in that body. Jesus, God the Son, will live and reign in that body forever. When he returns, all the saints will have their bodies translated or resurrected to be like his resurrected, glorious mankind body. See 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. God's commission to Adam. God put Adam in the paradisiacal garden and gave two commissions to him. The first was to reproduce himself, and the second was to take dominion over everything God had put on the earth. God told him to go to work by taking care of it, by keeping it in good shape, which was physical work. He then told him to do some mental work by naming all the birds of the air and animals of the field. I can imagine Adam asking, "What names do I give all the creatures you created?" And God responding, "Whatever name you give them will be fine. I want you to exercise your will and name them whatever you want. My will is for you to name them with the creative mind I gave you. I created this earth and fixed it up for you. It is yours to rule and enjoy with the wisdom I put within you. Remember, I am the one who created you to look like me outwardly and have the inner motivation of my heart and the thoughts of my mind. I gave all this for your joy and fulfillment. I am your creator father, and you have inherited much of my DNA, divine nature attributes, and abilities." God would likely continue, "It is my pleasure to give you the kingdom of this world to be your home and the place where you will raise your family. I am appointing you to take care of and develop the earth the same as I would. I'm not going to do it for you. I have put within you all you need to govern this earth. I will be visiting with you and will be available to help if you encounter something you do not know how to handle. But I am not going to be holding your hand all the time and telling you everything to do. Use your heart, mind, and hands that I gave you. I will be watching over you from heaven 24 hours a day. When you face something that is bigger than you and seemingly beyond your present capabilities, just call upon me, and I will be a present help in your time of need." See Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Adam's need that he could not meet. So Adam started naming all the creatures, and he began noticing something that seemed to be consistent. There would be two animals that looked alike, but each member of the pair was different from the other. One had male characteristics, like him, but the other had different characteristics. Since God had named him man, he would call the one that looked more like him male and the other one female. He noticed they were comparable and compatible with each other. When he named the long-necked creature giraffe, there was a male and female. The same was true with the horse, dog, cow, monkey, lion, and ape. He kept looking for someone who would be comparable and compatible with him. God came by one day and noticed that Adam looked a little sad and confused. Adam said, Lord, I've noticed something. You told me to use my mind and think things through. I've noticed that every male animal has a female that looks like him and seems to be comparable and compatible. I am a male, but I've not found my female that is like me, somehow different but comparable and compatible. God said to Adam, "Didn't I tell you that if you found a need you couldn't meet, I would do for you what you couldn't do for yourself? Come and lie down here, and let me give you a knockout drop. And when you wake up, I think you will love what I will have for you." God opened Adam's side, took out a rib, and closed the flesh back up. God took that rib and made a woman. Adam awoke, opened his eyes, and saw her. He jumped up with great excitement and said, "You shall be my wife and co-reign with me over all things on earth. I will call you Eve, for you shall be the mother of all living. You shall now be bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, for you were taken from my side." See Ephesians chapter 5, verses 30 through 32. God did not make Eve from the dust of the earth as he did Adam, but made her from substance taken from Adam's side. This becomes symbolic of the bride of Christ being taken from the pierced side of Jesus Christ. After my wife and I were married, I would tease her by saying, "You know, the first woe to man was woe, man, woman." Then I would say, "God made man first, then after that he made woman, and woman has been after man ever since." One day she got back at me. She said, "Honey, I read in the Bible that man was made out of just common dirt, but woman was not made out of dirt. Woman was made out of refined flesh, and woman has been that far advanced beyond man ever since." The Garden, a Little Bit of Heaven. Adam and Eve lived in Eden for an unknown amount of time, but they were not allowed to stay indefinitely. The reason for this had to do with the two unique trees God had put right in the middle of the garden. They could eat of the tree of life, which would allow them to keep living as long as they kept eating of it. But God had put another tree there that he commanded them not to eat of, for if they did, death would begin to work in their bodies, and they would die. One day, Eve became curious about the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Satan had come to her in the form of the serpent and had said, "Have you noticed how pleasant the fruit on this tree looks to your eyes? It has a tantalizing taste, greater than that of any other fruit you have eaten in the garden. If you will eat of it, you will become very wise, like God himself." Eve ate of the fruit of the tree and gave some to Adam, and he ate also. When they did, something happened to them. They saw things with their eyes that they had not knowingly seen before. They looked at each other and realized they had been walking with God.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.